Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Birmingham, University of Birmingham, for the 10th FISU World University Squash Championships. This afternoon is an action-packed afternoon of semi-final day, where we have the ladies starting with a match which is due on court in the next couple of minutes between Alexa Pienaar of South Africa versus Zoe Fu of Malaysia. That will be followed by a second ladies semi-final with Lily Taylor from Great Britain taking upon a match against Aika Azman from Malaysia. But I think we'll just listen to the players being announced on the court. So there's been some upsets in the tournament to this point. Alexa Pienaar was a 5-8 seed at the start of the tournament. She actually defeated the number one seed Great Britain player, Grace Gear, yesterday afternoon, to take her place in the semi-final. Zoe Fu was also a 5-8 seed. She was successful in a 3-love match yesterday against Sheena Bithana. From Australia, but the general feeling is that this championships is wide open. The semi-finals can go either way. All players believe that they've got a good chance in this draw. And I know at the start of the tournament it was a very difficult draw to seed, with a lot of the players being very similar in standard. Joining me in the commentary booth today is a former University of Birmingham student. Also ex-professional squash player, Chris Truswell, wearing lots of hats this week. Chris, you were also the Master of Ceremonies and Assistant Tournament Director.
Assistant to the Tournament Director.
Sorry, Assistant to the Assistant.
Yeah, I'm trying to put myself about this week. Do as much as I can.
You're renowned, Chris, for your kind of statistician type qualities in lots of sports, not just in squash. Do you know anything about these two players, and have you managed to see much squash this week?
I have been known to have quite a lot of useless information in my head. I actually saw Alexa play last night when she beat the top seed Grace Gear from England 3-0. That's the first time I'd seen her play, but she was very impressive last night. Actually, I think she surprised Grace with her level. I know that she doesn't play much PSA. She's played a couple of tournaments recently and had a couple of good results. But yeah, she was very sharp last night, and she closed the game out pretty comfortably, actually. As far as other squash, I've seen bits and bobs, but not that much, actually. I've been in the office.
Yeah, I was just saying, as you sat down, it's been quite an awkward draw to seed, and I guess that comes with the fact that some of the players at university are already playing PSA and starting to build a ranking, and they might do that from quite early in their university lives, whereas I guess some of the players haven't done that as much. They might be playing a standard equivalent to some of the guys who've already got those rankings, but they've not got the results on tour to show for it, and I guess the upsets have shown that they're certainly at that level.
Yeah, I think there's it's a bit of a mixed bag, really. The as you say, some of the players, both on the men and women, play PSA and play quite regularly, and then other players have played previously and then have stopped when they're at university. And then some players who haven't played PSA at all, but obviously have got quite a good level. I think Alexa probably falls into that category where she maybe because of being down in South Africa, that she probably hasn't, you know, she hasn't travelled with the squash, but she's obviously playing well. And I think Zoe, she played a bit of PSA before she went to university. That's why her ranking has dropped a little bit, because obviously when she's at college in America, and again they don't they play a lot of squash, but it's not PSA.
I guess obviously you've played on the tour yourself as well. Is that just partly reflecting the fact there's probably less events for Alexa to play? Maybe he's been based in Africa, whereas in Malaysia and kind of
certainly more for Zoe, and she was, before she went to university, she'd have had the chance to play a lot of those circuit events in Malaysia and in South Africa. They're just, I mean, there's a handful, but it's not. You know, in Malaysia there's probably 12 events a year that she could play. In South Africa you're probably looking at two or three maybe, so it's a big difference. Now, I guess you haven't seen either of these play before, so...
No, it's the first time. I'm just watching the knock-up, and interesting to see how both players kind of at the start the opening game, really, and see what the game plan is.
Well, I'll let you watch the warm up, but then obviously we have to do a prediction, even if you're not basing it on very much. I'll go first because I have seen a little bit more squash than you, I think, last couple of days. I think this could potentially be quite a long match. I think I'm going to go 3-1 to Zoe Fu.
3-1 to Malaysia.
Yeah.
Is this one of these where I have to then take the other side and actually kind of deliberately oppose your view and go for the South African? I haven't
you
not
can,
seen.
You can piggyback on me if you want, but it's not very original.
Yeah, I mean, I think when I looked at the draws and just knowing the strength of the Malaysian team from watching them at the British Opens and things, my gut feeling is that potentially this could be a Malaysian win as well. I'm going to go 3-0, and we'll go for some tight games, maybe some tie breaks along the way, we'll see. While we're just waiting for the players to come back on the court, maybe he's getting some final instructions from their coaches. Do you know anything about the players in the second semi-final? Obviously, we've got a great British interest from Lily Taylor. I think she's at Bristol University. She's playing against Aika Asman. Have you managed to see either of those players this week?
Yeah, I saw them both play yesterday. And I think that will be another good match, actually. I think, I think Lily, she dropped her opening game and then was quite comfortable after that. I think that was just because... It was the first match on the glass. Obviously, takes a little bit of getting used to. And once she got going, she played very well. And Asman, she was very dominant in a quarterfinal match yesterday. So it'll be interesting to see how their styles match up.
Could be an interesting game. I know Lily comes from good stock, and she has her dad Simon was a professional squash player. I think we've seen him somewhere in the audience today. So. Although Josh Taylor is the coach of the Great Britain team, there's a chance that maybe Simon will be also
fighting out for coaching
advice,
duties there.
Well, that ball just died in the back there, didn't it? She missed the volley and nothing coming back out the back corners then. Both players in the first two rallies struggling to get the ball out the back corners there. Is the court being playing a bit dead? Do you know?
It's quite a dead court. Yeah, it's same as most glass courts. If you hit a good length, then you tend to get rewarded. It certainly fades away in the back corner. So that's got to be where you're aiming to get that ball.
I think if you were the coach of either player, they'd be noticing that, you know, good length. When the ball was missed on the volley, it very quickly died in the back corners, and both players were struggling to get the ball back there. So, one thing we didn't talk about in the intro is Do you know anything about the players in terms of their university lives, in terms of what they might be studying at university? Or
yeah, I do actually. I was chatting to Alexa yesterday, and she's actually a fine art student in Johannesburg, which it's quite interesting. I think quite an interesting course. And Zoe is studying organisational services at George Washington. I'm not entirely sure what that is. I must admit.
No, that's not a course I'm familiar with in terms of any students at Birmingham having studied. I think it's probably both a bit easier for us to understand what fine art is, organisational services. Although you've been putting your organisational hat on this morning this week.
A bit of that, yeah.
Yeah. First long rally of note. Let me just feeling each other out a little bit and get their legs moving.
This is a tight ball. It's, I think they probably both want to play the way in a little bit in this first game. Like you said, the first couple of rallies were very short. I think a good idea would be to try and overhit the length rather than underhit it, just to start to feel a bit more comfortable.
But I'm sure both players will be nervous. Semi-final, like I said, just sometimes playing your way in, getting in and hitting the back walls. Because there's been a few little errors from both players so far. Probably hasn't quite settled himself down just yet.
Definitely, I mean, it's a semi-final of the World University Championships, so it's quite a prestigious title on the line, really. There's been some very, very strong winners of both men's and women's events over the years.
I think alluding to what you said earlier as well, the fact that they haven't necessarily played that much PSA, possibly a little bit before university, this could be one of the biggest matches they've played, and both players might not be that familiar playing on a glass court.
Definitely. I think Alexa probably hasn't played on a glass court like this anyway, until yesterday.
Has taken an early lead here, so my prediction could be out the window if she goes on to win this first game.
That's a nice good length. That's a good length, yeah.
As you well know, Chris, I'm not renowned for my betting. Success with bets and predictions, and typically
you're not the man to ask for a dead cert, are you?
No, if I give you a dead certainty, you'd probably put a good chunk of money on the other side. Unfortunately, I don't have the same amounts of useless information.
Useless information.
You carry about with you on a regular basis. So.
It's a nice finish.
She's done that a few times on the volley, hasn't she? Just taken it in quickly to the front. Again with a glass court, it's gone in quick, has stayed short, and then it's led Zoe to struggle to get there.
Be volleyed that. I don't think it's going to. Once it's dropped past that point, it's not coming back out.
It's a different. It's a good shot.
It's been nip and tuck this first game so far. No one's really taken control of it, have they? They're almost taking it in turns to play good rallies. No one's dominating for a period of time.
I'm going back to what I was just saying, I tried to interrupt you there, but a lot of short rallies, a lot of quick rallies, and I think they're not quite yet in a rhythm, and the key thing is they're not necessarily stringing 2-3 points together in a row. And that was an example there, but Alexa could have just took that point and put a 3-point lead. She'd be a strong favourite. Now it's anyone's game again, isn't it?
That's a rarity, isn't it? The lob serve out. I haven't seen one of those yet this week.
An example of the ball didn't really come out, got an example of balls from the back corners there.
As well, so
at least if I was taking your advice, you said a bit of overhitting, just get the ball hitting the back wall, get your tee position.
Definitely on this court, it's overhitting is not going to do you any harm. Whereas if you're only if the ball's only landing around the front of the service box, you're probably going to put yourself under pressure.
I've got a game ball here. Prediction of 3-1 still stands. I'm obviously out straight away. Will not surprise anybody who knows me that I've yet again made a false prediction. Having said that, I mean, if I was to change my prediction now based on that first game, I think Zoe's made quite a lot of errors and Lexi looked quite strong, so
she was a little bit more steady, wasn't she, towards the end of that game. So she'll be happy with that, because obviously winning that first game, it settles. She should feel a lot more settled now, just by having that first game on the scoreboard.
I think it goes back to what you're saying, though. 8 minutes is it's not a long first game, that really, is it, by squash standards? And I think there was a few errors from both players, some rallies that where the rally was quite short, dying in the back corners, and the scoreboard was ticking along quite quickly. So, if you were coaching Zoe, what would you be? What advice would you be giving her?
It's nothing groundbreaking, but she's got to hit the ball into the back corner. She's got to hit straighter and deeper. Anything that's landing around the service box is going to put her under more pressure. And anything that clips the sidewall and pops out as well is also going to be putting her on the back foot. So first things first is to probably use a little bit more height on the length and get it to the back of the service box. And then she'll have the chance to get up on the tee and maybe kind of get in front of Alexa a little bit. I think Alexa at the end of that game was just in front of her and she was sort of pinning her back a little bit. So she needs to, before she thinks of doing anything else, is just to get that length in the back and then go from there.
I agree with that. I mean, obviously, very standard kind of coaching, isn't it, we're giving between games, but you mentioned about the volume as well. I think if she doesn't get that tee position, she's got to start putting that ball off and stop letting those balls go past the racket too easily. So one love from the ball.
Nice finish, but it's in the middle of the court from Fu.
End of the rally from Alexa. She dominated that rally from start to finish, didn't she, really? And a good shot there, tight on the wall. Again, we talk about glass court play, but it's very hard to get the ball off the walls. And there's been two or three examples of that already. Oh, that's a loose one. I don't think we've got video referee in this tournament, have we? But we do have a video referee. We apologise for that. Yeah, we do have a video referee, but I don't think you'd have been called into question there. That was an obvious stroke there.
It's another nice finish. That Foo needs to keep that away from the backhand volley around the midcourt, because she's hit two in a row there.
Quick attack there to the backhand front corner. Again, she's letting the ball go past the racket there. Thank you. be the longest volley of the match here. Nice finish.
Yeah, she's clearly got some good racket skills.
Alexa started this game very well. She's dominating the tee. Hard volley possibly took a bit out of her there, but a couple of loose points and she suddenly finds herself 4-3 behind. Again, scoreboard's just racing along here, 5-3.
It's
been a mental lapse, hasn't it? There's been two or three cheap points there, and it's gone from being 3-1, I think, to 6-3 straight through.
Fast points, that's a nice angle. She liked that one.
It's given some momentum, and you saw the reaction there from Zoe. Okay, it's swinging a step, don't you? Sometimes squash is one of those games where momentum is huge.
It doesn't take very much for it to shift quite quickly as well, does it? Like you say, it's one or two points and it starts to look a bit different.
I'm sure if you were guilty of this, Chris, but I'm certainly was guilty of just sometimes overthinking those things as well. And you lose your concentration, lose two or three rallies, and before you know it, you've lost your game plan.
No, I rarely overthink anything, John. that's my problem.
Seven in a row now. It's been a huge momentum shift in this second game.
Yeah, I think what Alexa needs to.
Oh, lovely shot.
That was a good shot. Yeah, I think she just needs to stop this run of points, and it's not an insurmountable deficit. This.
Back to basics, decent length, put the pressure on, another weak shot coming out the back corners there from Zoe. She did that a lot in the first game. Okay, well, I haven't seen it so much in this run of points where she just lost. 5-8, still a chance. That's a lovely shot, wasn't it?
Nice bit of hold there. Should have two or three different options from that setup.
Well, we're seeing Zoe constantly in front now, aren't we?
She's really, yeah, she's certainly got hold of the tee. And Alexa's doing the majority of the work at the moment.
It's almost a reverse, isn't it, of what we were talking about at the end of the first game. Now Alexa needs to get back to basics, get her length back and try and regain some tee position. Because when she is in the tee, she's got, as we just demonstrated there, that's a lovely shot to the front corner. She's got good hands on the volley, but she hasn't been there enough this game, has she? Second game ball for Zoe Fu. Rarity, isn't it? You don't see many aces. I mean, I know you're a big fan of the US Open tennis.
Grass court tennis stuff there, yeah.
Cheap point and squash is harder to come by, isn't it? It's not very rare we get an ace.
That's a nice finish. So Fu levels up at one game all.
Well, I think on the balance of play, it's about right, isn't it? I mean, Alexa was probably just edging the first game, a little bit stronger towards the back end of the first game, and deserved to take that, but... Although she started in the same vein at the start of that game and went 3-1, and then from that point onwards, you'd say Zoe Fu took control. So 16 minutes, again another short game. I think certainly point of rally scoring has sped up the game. And am I right in thinking, Chris, that we're using 17-inch tin like they would use in PSA for all matches this week as well?
Yeah, the tin's at 17-inch for men and women.
I think that does make a difference at this level, doesn't it? You know, we're comparing maybe to PSA, top professional players who are used to playing on a glass court and on a 17-inch tin and are training day in, day out. I think obviously that would lend itself to the longer rallies potentially.
I think especially on the glass, where just because of the deadness of the court, makes the court feel longer, but with going long and short anyway, when the tin's down at 17, if you're not used to that, then it certainly has an effect. I think you'll find that players, there are balls that they might expect to get back on a 19-inch tin or even on a 17-inch tin on a plastic court, but on the glass, it's the ball just stays that a little bit closer up at the front wall, and you almost feel like your racket's not long enough, or you're playing with a shorter racket.
15 seconds. So what you're saying there, really, for anyone who's tuning in who's a non-squash player, is that you essentially have to just move that little bit further forwards, and potentially the ball's staying that little bit further back, isn't
half,
it?
You know, half step, or you know, it doesn't sound like a lot, but it is actually when you're on there, when you're into, when it's every step needs to be a little bit, you have to move a little bit further.
It's the difference between balanced on the ball and hitting comfortably, isn't it, and just playing a little bit under pressure with a stretch, and suddenly you're not in as much control. It's one game all. It's Zoe Fu to serve, and it's love all. On that, was she running? Was she? She got it back, but yeah, couldn't do anything with that shot from the Malaysian. Potentially, this is a big part of this match for Alexis. She just seems to have gone a bit flat, hasn't she, from that first game? And, she started badly here, lost the first three rallies. I think she just needs to. There you go. Get herself on the scoreboard, put a couple of good rallies together, and just try and settle back down.
Yeah, she just, easier said than done, but going back to basics, maybe trying to slow like Zoe in that second game. Yeah, she obviously had a very quick run of points, and the game just ran away quickly, so it's almost sort of taking her time, going back to basics and just seeing if she can work her way back into this match.
I mean, even this rally, if she was to go on and lose it, she's a longer rally, she's going to get her legs going a bit again.
Good use of height.
Control there. Just the rally she needed, isn't it? Just shifting our seating position around there. We're on a gantry overlooking the court here, and it's also a walkway. People trying to get past. Easily got past you, Chris, didn't they? But struggled to get past me.
No comment.
As you know from being away with me this summer in America, we've been coaching over there. Unfortunately, American food and calories got the better of me, so got back to basics since I got back to England. Made apparent by the fact that people can't get past us on the corridor. It was an awkward ball for it, wasn't it?
It was a trick shot there.
Didn't quite know how to play that.
Quite work, but she's still in control of this rally. She's holding.
She's got Alex doing a lot of work here, hasn't she?
All over the place.
It's a hard rally for her there, wasn't it?
Yeah. Alexa won't. She won't stop running. I know that. But rallies like that are not going to make life easy for her.
Did you said you'd watched the semi-final yesterday, is that right? You saw her play against Grace Gear?
I watched the quarter-final, yeah. She won 3-0. And, I thought she played very well. I know Grace has been injured, but
I think I heard Grace had had a 3-2 match in the morning.
She was 2-0 up, and the Austrian girl got back to 2-2, and but Grace won the fifth quite easily. She stepped up again in the fifth, but that probably didn't help her physically, because it was just two matches in a day yesterday, so getting off court quickly is definitely key.
I think that was Jacqueline Peychard who was playing
Austria.
Yeah. As we said, the fourth game was a very close game, but actually the fifth game is quite one-sided. But I think if she has been coming back with an injury, I know she was wearing a strapping. Potentially hard to back up those matches when you've been out for a little while.
Yeah, certainly, especially if you've had the matches, it's a shock to the system. Pinos taking back control of this game. All of a sudden, the scoreboard has reversed.
Been a lot of momentum swings, hasn't there? I mean, we're just thinking that there she needed to get off to a good start to being 3-0 down. Just settle down, and suddenly you find yourself 7-5 up quite quickly. It's all gone a bit mid-court, hasn't it? And short, and a lot of play around the middle, but neither player's really stretching it here.
That's a better shot. Yeah, I mean they need to find those four floorboards, which I'm sure they use in practice a lot.
Well, both players have proven that when they do get the ball to the back, there's cheap points to have back there.
Definitely.
But
yeah.
It's become a bit forced and a bit short, and a bit, as you mentioned earlier, kind of in front of the middle of the service box as opposed to behind the back of the service box. Again, the rallies have got quicker as a consequence. She does play that shot nicely. She's done a few of those.
They both do, and it's at that sort of height and angle. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for coming, isn't it? Yeah. It's the shot we all want, really. So from 3-0 behind, we're now 10-5 game ball. And chance of going 2-1.
In there.
Well, I'm pleased to say that means that's the end of your prediction. Obviously, Zoe could still go on to win this match, but she can't win it 3-1, so all of that knowledge that you had prior, or as you did say, limited useless knowledge.
Yeah, I mean this is it's a tough match to call really, because like in the three games now we've had probably five or six momentum switches, so who knows what's going to happen in the fourth. It seems like one of the girls will go 3 or 4 points up, and then there'll be another run of points the other way, and it's who can concentrate for the longest really and put those rallies together for a sustained period of time. I'm still going to stick with a Fu win, even if it's not 3-1.
Well, it's going to have to be 3-2, isn't it? Looking at the scoreboard that we have in front of us right now. I do agree with what you're saying. I mean, the momentum switches have been huge here. I mean, at 3-0 down in that game, there was a good chance that Zoe was just going to walk through that game and find herself 2-0, and then suddenly she's won two of the next 13 rallies or whatever it was. Find herself 11-5. I do feel as if Zoe Fu was kind of forcing that a little bit in the mid stages. That there was a couple of rallies where she did win them, but again it was a lot of kind of hard hitting in mid court, and Alexa was kind of scrambling them back. But she definitely lost that structure of just finding a length, using a drop shot, making Alexa be a little bit more under pressure in the front corners.
Sometimes on the glass court, the harder you hit it, the shorter it. You know, you can hit the ball very hard, but it doesn't go anywhere, and you just end up using a lot of energy and not getting any reward for it. You see that quite a lot, especially with people that haven't played that much on the glass. It's try and hit it, hit the ball hard, but unless you can kind of use that height on the front wall a little bit, probably a little bit more than you would on a normal pasta court, your length ends up being a fair bit shorter.
Yeah, I think again it's something you see a lot on PSA, where they're just how effective they are hitting the ball above the service line. Not just in terms of lobbing and lifting, but just kind of using good height, good width, and maintaining that tee position. Second time today someone can't get past the commentary booth. To try and move this chair forward.
Start in this fourth game for Alexa. I think Zoe certainly doesn't want to give away any more cheap points because the match will be over.
She seems to look a bit of a confidence player to me, Alexa. She's looking kind of her body language, and she looks confident here.
She's sort of got the bit between her teeth, hasn't she?
She did, yeah.
So, from midway through that third game.
She just came off it a little bit in that second game. And then your body language changed and her kind of confidence seemed to ebb away, but then since that momentum shifted back, you look at her now, she's up on her toes, she's bouncing around, she feels confident, looking for the volley. And if Zoe doesn't do something soon, she's going to find herself with a bit of a mountain to climb. It's a good volley again from Alexa, that's a lovely shot down the wall.
I'd appreciate that one.
Yeah, there's a lot of South Africans there watching at the top there, aren't they? They're giving some support. And
they are very vocal. They're a vocal crowd, actually, the South Africans. You do see that. Supporting each other.
One thing I didn't mention in my intro, and I meant to, is just how many nations there are competing here. There's about, I think there's 19 different nations competing in this event. But I think certainly one of the largest contingents have probably been the South Africans in terms of numbers of both entrants of and also the entourage.
Yeah, they've got a fairly big group. I think China have got quite a large group as well. And then on the other side, Spain is a party of one.
Yeah.
So it's a mix, but it's good to see so many countries represented. Come from South America, Asia, Africa. We've got Uganda, South Africa, North America, and Canada, and quite a lot of European countries as well. So it's really a very international event. Good lob.
Got a bit edgy there, didn't she? She had probably more time.
Hesitated a little bit. Yeah, she.
Sometimes the worst shots to have, aren't you? You get so much time on the ball and you overthink
too much,
it.
Too much time. It's nice how hard. I do like to see a lob.
So effective, isn't it, on this court?
Shots. Yeah. It's good to mix up the pace as well. And back to parity. It's thought Alexa was about to run away with this game. And
again, I'm just looking at body language, and again she's lost 3 points, and suddenly that little bounce in between points is gone. When she's winning, she likes to get on with things quickly, doesn't she? She's kind of there. She's won that rally. She wants to get on with it. It's almost that reset that she needs when she does lose a rally or lose a couple of rallies and just kind of get back to what she was doing. So you're through doing a lot of work here. Trying to hit herself out of trouble a little bit, although length is a little bit short. I think he's going to do some interviewing of both Alexa and Zoe, as well as probably the announcements for the next matches onto court. So we'll see what Chris has got to say here.
Opponents London where we were high Euro incubator. She's from Malaysia, she's the second city of this tournament. Please welcome Mike Kazma.
So welcome back to what is going to be the second of our ladies' semi-finals here. This one has actually gone with the seeding. Lily Taylor of Great Britain, 3-4 seed, has won through by beating Hayley Ward in the quarterfinal stage. She won that match 3-0, close game in the second game, but won 3-0. Aka Azman has had a fairly straightforward path through as well. She beat Kao Wing Ho from Hong Kong to reach the semi-final stage. For the second match of today's semi-finals, we've got a new person moving into the commentary box in Jack Turney. Jack's a local professional player based in Birmingham, was a student here as well. So welcome, Jack.
Well, thanks very much, John. It's a pleasure to be here. Thoroughly enjoyed the previous match between Alexa Pienaar and Zoe Fu. I thought Alexa played fantastically well, sort of settled early on and adapted to the conditions quite quickly. But Fu showed plenty of fight. Say she was a Fu fighter, am I right? And it was a World Cup in a game and 3-1 to Pienaar. Really impressed.
It's interesting, before the last match we made some predictions. Chris Truswell led me astray slightly because, having watched some of the semi-finals yesterday, he'd predicted that that Fu was going to win that match. It went for 3-1. I then kind of piggybacked on the back of him and said it would be 3-1. 3-0 even. So I was completely wrong. So I'm aware that you may not know Aika that well, but I'm understanding that you may be from Leicestershire, which is where Lily's from, and you know her quite well. Would you like to give us any background or any thoughts or predictions on this match, Jack?
Yeah, well, it's a pleasure for my first commentating job to be on a great British player. I do know Lily quite well, and we're both Leicestershire in both being coached by Simon Taylor, obviously Simon being Lily's father, and I'm going to back Lily for this one. She's had quite a bit more game time than her Malaysian opponent, but you got to back GB in these situations. What about you, Tatey?
Yeah, I mean, you'd mentioned Simon there. I think is that Simon sat in the front row? Is he sat
next to Josh Taylor?
Looks like he might be sat next to Josh Taylor in the front row. Yeah, possibly. I find this a tough one because, as you're aware, Lily is a player who is a very good junior, and unfortunately junior university life has struggled through injuries. I think prior to going to university she had some kind of shin splints or shin fracture which stopped her from training. It's nice to see her back playing well and back at this level, to be honest, but I haven't seen enough of her recently to know what her level is, but perhaps being from England, trying to support England, I'd like to see an English victory in this one, as much as we're supposed to be impartial in the commentary box. And I think I'll go with your suggestion. Maybe it's a Lily win in four. What did you say? You said Lily, but
I'm going to go Lily 3-2.
3-2. Yeah. So you're expecting a long game here?
I think so, yeah. I think it's going to be a classic.
So again, you mentioned that you're both from Leicestershire. Were you both at the same club, Jack? Or were you growing up? Or did you used to travel to where Lily's club was to coach with Simon?
Yeah, well, we did some of the county training sessions together every now and again. And sort of once a year I saw her at the county close as well. My sister played, I think, a couple of times as well. I think, actually, my mum played it once when I'm not sure how old she was, but my mum retired after playing Lily when Lily was 13 and my mum lost, so... but yeah,
put a tourney into retirement, did she?
She put it, yeah. Well, two of them actually, my sister as well. So,
Well, your sister did continue to play at university as well, didn't she, to be fair?
She did.
So it didn't quite take two tourneys out in quick succession there. Is there an age gap between you two, Jack? I'm just wondering if you were ever hitting partners or...
I can't remember. I don't know how old Lily is, unfortunately. 21.
Is she 21? She's 30.
Yeah, we didn't
do
any.
She's going into third year at Bristol, I believe.
We didn't really hit with each other at all.
It's a small age gap there, and you just went to see Sam for coaching. There are two Taylors, aren't there? There is another girl who was, her sister Mary was almost, I suppose, another player who would have been looking to try and get into this team. Perhaps, I think she's the younger sister and maybe looking to get into the GB team for the next World University Championships.
She's currently at Nottingham Trent.
Yeah, one of your hitting partners and friends, Miles Jenkins, he's the coach at Nottingham Trent. I think he does some work with Lily's sister, doesn't he?
Yeah, I think and Miles has been doing an absolutely fantastic job. They call him Dr. Jenks over there, because he's really spun it round, and he's they've done terrifically well. Like, I think they just missed out on reaching the semi-finals of the Bucks teams event. I think that's right, isn't it?
Yeah, I think they did very well last
just
year.
Just lost to, it could have been West of England.
They had a 3-2 match, didn't they? And I think it went down to one player losing 12-10 in the fifth game. And
if you said that a few years ago, I mean, you know, the rise of Nottingham Trent has been.
Yeah, well, of course.
Very quick, hasn't it? And Miles has been a big part of that. So if you're watching, Miles, there's your shout out.
I'm led to believe that some of those players are. Has he gone to Russia, or is he going to Russia for a tournament?
He's, I think he's got sort of Danish league or this weekend. Or, but he has got a tournament in Russia at the moment as well.
So we talked a lot about Lily. Was just getting something passed across to us about Aika. I think she's 21 years old as well, so they may have come across each other before in junior squash, either World Juniors or British Junior Open. We'd have to look that up. But she's studying sports management, and she's currently ranked 111 in the world. She had a highest ranking of 80. I think Chris was alluding to this in the previous commentary, but some of the players have played a lot of PSA prior to going to university, and then maybe he's not playing as many tournaments, hence their ranking has dropped. Whereas other players, maybe he's now starting to build that ranking, it's been a difficult draw for them to seed as a consequence of those rankings. But certainly, you'd guess she'd be a top 100 player, and I guess Lily would be the same, wouldn't she?
Yeah, absolutely. I think both these players are quite athletic, and you see from that opening point there, they've found their length early in this match. Not as a lucky volley. But then if you're volleying it, you get the rewards, don't you? So
I'm not sure she was intending to do the volley boast there.
Obviously, Tater, you're a head coach here at Birmingham. Is the volley something you promote massively when you're doing those sessions on a Tuesday evening?
Well, as you should know, Jack, I hopefully remember that was a big part of what we're trying to get you to do. Get the basics right. It's very difficult in group sessions, isn't it, to change technique, but certainly you can talk tactics. And either we were talking again in the previous commentary about 17-inch tin, how that's changed, and how maybe these players are struggling to adapt to 17-inch tin, maybe more traditionally used to playing in a 19-inch tin. The game, you know, the basics are still there, aren't they, for whether you're playing 17-inch or 19-inch tin. Well, obviously you were at university when you were playing as all pretty much 19-inch tin. Now you've moved across into PSA, you're doing a lot of practice on the 17-inches. How do you find that as a player, getting used to that?
Well, it's difficult because you're used to the whole time in your squash career playing on the 19-inch tin, and then the transition, it can be quite difficult. My short game's not really my forte, so I can't say it's been massively advantageous for me. But certainly going short, you get put under more pressure, don't you, over the lower tin.
Well, Chris would explain to anyone who's not a squash player listening to this just how essentially makes the court slightly bigger. You end up having to move that little bit further to the ball, to the front corners particularly. And it potentially affects the quality of your shots and your balance on the ball. As you said, it tends to favour those players who are aggressive and like to take the ball in quickly to the front.
Not only that, with the lower tin and being on the full glass court as well, the ball is more deader.
Yeah, it's staying even further forwards. Well, this is almost the perfect start here from the lead, isn't it? I mean, we've been talking about kind of generic squash things, and she's raced to a 7-0 lead and looked very dominant here.
It's a lovely shot.
And there's a good example of quick attack to the front and the glass ball stayed very short. And Michael was very... Well, she was nowhere near that, was she, really, let's be honest. Another lovely shot there.
She had a high drop shot, didn't she, in Malaysian? You know, if you're high on the drop, the rally will stop.
So difficult. We talked in the previous commentary again about how it is kind of how you need to settle down, settle the nerves.
Well, the previous match, the opening few points, it was incredibly nervy, wasn't it? It was a lot of balls being hit out at the top and a lot of tins. But
lots of short rallies, lots of quick points. But I mean, obviously from Lily's perspective here, she's settled down beautifully and got straight up and running. Aiko, on the other hand, is really struggling to find a rhythm. There's a first point in the ball, but at 10-0, she just needs to try and stay in this game, I would say. Try and get two or three points at least.
Just to settle the nerves.
Yeah, try and come back a bit stronger at the start of the second game. Very unlikely that she'll come back and win from this position. Not impossible, but we don't see those comebacks much with point rally scoring. But I think you were asking me about a forehand drop, and I didn't take the bait. What was that about? Kind of a high back swing and a forehand drop.
It was a silly little rhyme. It's a good one for juniors to remember.
Do you want to repeat it?
I don't think so. I think it's more of a moment. But I suppose whenever you're going for those drop shots, you need to run it in tight so the rally's out of sight. I'll just put the notepad away now, I think.
I don't have my notepad with me, so unfortunately my puns and rhymes book was left with the kids this morning.
Well, that's a 4-minute first game for Lily, absolutely dominating here, 11-1.
Yeah, I mean, we talked again, I keep referring back to previous commentary, but we said an 8 and 9 minute first game was a short game. I mean, that's 4 minutes, and it's absolutely kind of, I mean, you'd be surprised if they really got out of breath too much in that game. There's a lot of quick short rallies. Very aggressive from Lily, and obviously a perfect start. But I think Aika is going to have to try and settle herself down at the start of this second game. Otherwise, your prediction of a grueling 3-2 may not be on the cards.
I mean, in fairness, I actually haven't seen Aika play before, but I saw the scores from the previous matches. Thought of Lily with the previous 3-2 that she had in the previous round quarterfinal. Was it 3-2 in the quarters, or did she win quite convincingly?
You're talking about Lily's previous match. It's a very good question because we've suddenly buried all of the draw. Lily, she won her last match 3-0 against.
But the one before that.
Yeah. I mean, it's been a very strong female draw, actually. There's 10 very strong girls in the draw. But as you said, we're seeing it a little bit blunted, doesn't it? It does affect your ability to make those predictions.
Thank you.
slightly better rally from Aika there. Seems as if she's probably been G'd up and told to be a bit more aggressive and try and get the tee. She did try and do that there, but then it was unfortunately an unforced error really on the drop shot.
Well, she's probably better off really just elongating the rally, just trying to find a length and be a bit more patient, because that was unorthodox.
She's almost missed that and then played the back wall box, didn't she? Well, this could be the first video review that we had. I actually misquoted earlier saying we didn't have video review, but we do have video review here.
Well, we did have one on a pickup, didn't we, in the previous match. Be interesting to see here. What do you think here, John?
I'm actually thinking it's going to stay as a no let, because I think Lily, for whatever reason, kind of almost stopped and didn't try and make her way through. Although it did actually look like she made more of an effort there on the
at
first glance, yeah. Same way again. It's a lovely drop shot she played. Oh, it was back to the previous rally, wasn't it?
They're playing a pace here, aren't they, John?
Well, I seem to not.
Oh, here we go.
See, I think she should be hitting that, do you, Jack?
Well, I don't see why she wouldn't hit it, to be honest.
I mean, there's a little bit of contact. I mean, there was contact, and you see it from that front angle where there was contact on the shoulder she went through, but potentially she's through the open court there. Yeah, the decision's been upheld, no less. That's just what Aika needs, at least get the nerves settled down, get on the scoreboard. A couple of points there, it's broken Lily's concentration.
Well, this is a great patch, isn't it, for Aika after that first game to get four solid points here.
Yeah, I agree, but it's again, a lot of this is actually Lily, isn't it?
It's exactly, yeah. It's, yeah.
She's kind of got in brawl with that no let, which she probably should have just gone through and played. Had she played that, she had momentum, she's going to probably just go on and win that rally, and instead she's kind of got fussed about the fact she didn't get the let. There was a long, long pause while they made the decision on whether it was going to be upheld or not, and suddenly you go a bit cold and you lose a couple of rallies, and before you know you are, you've given three away. Just needs again to use the back to basics, get a decent length, get the tee, and just re-establish some patterns. It's actually now better for Mike, isn't it? She is putting the ball deeper, higher, a bit more height.
A bit more pace as well.
More pace, yeah. Perhaps again, I think Lily just needs to react to that. She was winning the points so easily to start with that she just needs to just go back to basics. Rally a little bit, wait for the tee. So, yeah, she's kind of forced a quick boast there, and it was a nothing shot, really. Very, very much a Jack Journey drop shot there. I felt.
No chance.
That was an exceptional shot from the front there from Lily, wasn't it?
Yeah, showed plenty of options going short, didn't she? And cut it in.
She's getting stuck behind a lot though in the last few rounds. Hence that momentum we were talking about. Have you found transitioning from a student to a professional player? I mean, we talk about the mental side here, about concentration, but we saw it in the first match. We're seeing it again here. kind of lapses of concentration where you're losing 3 and 4 points. And I guess those higher ranked professionals just don't do that, do they?
Well, at the moment I'm training over at the ROA in West Warwick, and I'm playing a lot of guys that are better than me. People like Miles Jenkins, and Joel Makin, and Josh Masters is in this one tournament as well. And these guys just don't make those sort of errors at all. They never give you an easy point. No, there's nothing cheap.
Yeah. Well, Joel Makin, I mean, you mentioned some of the players there, but he's renowned for just the traditional play, keeping the ball in play, making you win every rally. And it must be great for you getting on court with him every day.
It's absolutely fantastic, and it's a great opportunity as well. But there is a side effect if you are playing people better than you all the time, that squash is also a massive game of confidence as well. And if you're not, you know, if you're feeling something negative when you're going on court, you know, you're trying to set yourself for an hour and a half match, you know, it can be quite damaging and detrimental to your game. So it's finding that balance really, and also playing people worse than you, so you can work on certain things and improve on certain things.
Well, I mean, Lily didn't regain her confidence there, or her composure, should we say. Lost that game 11-7, 9 minutes. But I really do think a lot of that was down to her just not recognising that Aika was a little bit better, used a bit more height, got the ball at the back, started getting on the volley, a bit more aggressive. And like I said, the points almost too easy to come by. I mean, you mentioned the R away. Rod Owen, is it? Coach over there. What would Rod be saying in between games here to try and get Lily back on track if she was one of the players in the group?
Well, he'd say fundamentally he'd say to keep it simple. I mean, there was a lot of cheap errors in that, a lot of going short too quickly and not being patient enough. You know, Rob himself is a bit of a shot player, but it's also you got to get down to basics really, and just try and find that length and be patient and wait for the good opportunity to go short. But when you're going short, you know, leave plenty of margin as well. You know, just putting them in the right areas and moving your opponent around the court. And I think that's what you'd say.
Mm.
Would you agree?
I would agree. Yeah, I think it's important for Lily here to just get back to basics, keep it simple. We know she's got a good attacking game. She showed that. Obviously, she was very aggressive at the start, but you can't generate those attacks if you're not getting the ball in the right areas. And obviously, I know something again that Rob would teach is using height. You know, there's times there where she's under a little bit more pressure, didn't use the height, didn't get the ball deep enough, and suddenly you get that momentum swing that we saw in that game. I mean, having not seen the players too much before this, from what I've seen, I do think this is a match that Lily can obviously win. We did predict that she would win, but we're doing that a bit blind. But based on what I've seen, but I do think it's very important she gets back to basics. So that's better, isn't it? It's just
better.
Very tight.
If it ain't tight, it ain't right.
There's very few glass courts around, aren't they? Jack, have you managed to get on many glass courts since you played?
I haven't really. I played in the one in Nottingham, where I famously played Marwan El-Shabagi.
I think I watched that match today. Let me guess, this was quite a close one thing, wasn't it?
You gave me some advice for I should be patient, I should be leaving margins going short, and I should be finding my length, I think.
Was that successful advice that day? Yeah.
Jack? Yeah, it wasn't too bad. I don't want to go on about it, to be honest. Lost 3-2 and 12-10 in the fifth.
12-10 in the fifth, but yeah. I think you had match ball, didn't you?
No, I didn't have match ball. I was 10-8 down, actually.
Oh, really?
I don't want to go on about it. I
thought you did actually get a match ball, and was thinking, my one's leaving this a little bit late.
Yeah, I can't say. I mean,
so you actually enjoyed the experience on the glass court?
Absolutely fantastic. It's completely different to the traditional courts. Just little things like the lights above the court. It's extremely bright, and I think it might have been you who told me to, I can't remember who it was, but just to stare at the lights before playing, so your eyes get used to the lights. But It really hurts.
I don't think I did give you that advice, but I do know what you mean. I think it's such an underrated shot, isn't it? Just a lob on a normal court compared to this court is, if you really get the ball in the legs, it would have been that white ball.
Much harder to time.
It can almost disappear for a fraction of a second, can't it? And you you do sometimes see them mistiming the ball when it's very high coming out of the lights.
Exactly. And there's also, you know, that you've got the cameraman as well in the corners of the on the front wall. You don't really notice unless you're playing a drop.
No, yeah.
And
I think the players can zone out, can't they?
Yeah.
We've talked about the tin and leaving the ball short, but obviously the glass court rewards a very good shot. If it's on the wall, it's very hard to get back. The lights come into play. So it's important that you can reflect and use those tactics if you're not experienced in the glass court. But suddenly, Aika's length's gone. Lily's raised to 8-2. And momentum swung again, Jack.
Quite a bizarre match, this one, isn't it? A lovely length. How does this court compare to the ones in Nottingham and Manchester as well?
Well, I'm just going off what the players were saying. I mean, I know Josh Masters was on there. He's played a few of his matches on there, but he was also practicing the other day. He said it was a nice glass court, but the ball's playing nice. He was rewarding a good shot. But they do suggest that the courts that are permanently erected and kind of stay there all the time, like the one in Nottingham, do play slightly differently to the courts that come up and down, like this one for this championship. And this court will be used again in this venue in January for the British Junior Open, but again it won't stay here permanently. It'll be kind of dismantled and then rebuilt for that tournament. So I mean, I don't believe that they were placed significantly different, do you? I mean, but I'm not sure what the difference of why a one that's permanently erected would play differently. So perhaps we can we'll get some tweets, Jack, on that, and maybe some of your squash followers could tweet in and tell us the difference.
Well, yeah, we may get one or two tweets. Can't say I'm really on Twitter that much, Stacey.
Really?
Yeah.
Was it Instagram?
No Snapchat or anything like that. I'm on Facebook. I've got a Facebook page called Boys Who Can Cook, so if anyone wants to like that, I've got 435 followers. So.
Are we just going to try and get that up to 500 followers by the
yes,
end
please.
Of today?
It's giving advice on nutrition and vitamins and minerals and what to consume as an athlete. So check that out, guys.
So for anyone tuning in, it's semi-final day. It's the second semi-final. This one is between Lily Taylor, Great Britain, and Aika Asman from Malaysia, 2-1 lead. A game that's had its ups and downs in terms of both players having the moments in the ascendancy, but Lily probably deserving the 2-1 lead overall. Been very convincing in the two games that she has won. A little bit of a lapse in the second game. That's a good shot from Aika.
Handout, one love.
Well, the match has been a bit all over the place, hasn't it? With momentum swinging both ways. How do you see this game going then, Tatey? Are we looking at 11-1 to the Malaysian or 11-3 to Lily?
Oh, that's a lovely shot there.
Handout.
Well, I think the next two or three points, I mean, normally you'd say in squash it's what's happening at the back end of the game, isn't it? But I think in the case of all these matches so far, it's kind of almost setting your stall out. I mean, we've had 5-6-0, and if you're not still in it kind of at that point, you're just not giving yourself any platform to try and be successful. So, I mean, I think from Aika's perspective, she needs to at least still be in the game at 6-all, 7-all, you know, start to try some play some big points later on in the game and not let Lily get into a big lead. And that's a little bit cheap there. She could have bolstered that ball higher and just stayed in the rally, at least make Lily hit a winner in the front court. That's one of my returns there, John. Another lucky shot off the frame.
You've been framed.
Not the first time people said that to me when I've been in court.
Out.
4-3. So again, it's just so little pattern, is there? I mean, both players can't get a lead here. They're not struggling for structure. Suddenly Lily's gone from looking very controlled, very dominant, to falling in the back corners.
Well, this is very strange.
Yeah.
I feel like Lily had it in the third game. She was finding her length. She was waiting for the good opportunities to go short. But in here, it's just, it seems like off the return of serve, she's posting it in the tin or not making an opponent work at all.
Stroke to asthma. Straight to asthma.
And now another stroke.
8-3.
We're at the risk of just, you know, we keep repeating ourselves, but I look at the body language and when they're winning, they're kind of, they're confident, they're bouncing on their toes, they can't wait to serve, but as soon as they start losing, it's almost like the doubts creep in, it gets a bit scrappy.
Damn.
It's so important, just, you know, win or lose, you just got to try and kind of stick to your game plan, know what you're trying to do.
And
4-8, I mean, it's still not lost for Lily, but she needs to put two or three good points in a row here, doesn't she? She'll be volleying that really potentially, I think. And that's where she's going to build that pressure in the mid-court.
Well, Lily is a very attacking player. She likes to go short, but you can also attack going to the back as well, can't you?
Yeah, I think that's something that you're saying, that your natural preference as a player is not necessarily going short. You know a lot about kind of trying to show short, attack the back corners. You can still put a lot of work into your opponent. That's a nice drop shot there. I think did you catch him in the follow-through, do you think? Is that really?
Yeah, it looks like it.
Are you okay, Miss Asman?
See it from this angle. What was the elbow? Do you think it was the elbow? It's quite nasty, isn't it? Looks as if she's okay to continue.
You okay to play on?
Referee just asking if she's okay to play on, I guess.
Left box.
She'll have to make a decision on that, or whether she wants to take an injury timeout. See if again that could affect concentration. See how Lily responds from here. English supporters, or Great Britain supporters, trying to get behind Lily there, give her a bit of a cheer and get her going a bit.
Oh.
Yes, let.
6-8. Well, I'm not sure what happened there. She seemed to just collapse, I think. But
I'm not sure why Lily was on her knees there, really. Did you catch the heel? I think there's a lack of experience here. I mean, Ike has got herself into a fantastic position. And that's such a cheap point. At that point, it's a huge point there at 8-6, isn't it? Just to bolster that in the tin there.
Yeah, from that position at 8-6, you've got to make your opponent work and earn every point, haven't you? But
well, point of rally scoring, isn't it? It's that those huge swings, what, you know, difference of two, difference of three, or almost kind of back 1 point in it. And psychologically, how you and you respond. You feel you've got a chance, don't you, when you close. Suddenly you get 3 or 4 behind, and it's very, very difficult with the scoring system to claw those points back.
Straight to Asman.
So we've got 10-7 game ball. Your prediction's looking good here, Jack.
I said 3-2. I said thriller as well.
It's not quite
very strange one. And she's done on knees again.
Game to Asman.
It's a lovely length as well from Asman at the end there.
We've talked a lot here about Lily, but I mean, I think the Malaysian was, again, she was a bit more solid there, wasn't she? There was less errors. Went and did some of the basics that you were talking about. But yeah, so Lily's kind of, she's either hot or cold here, and there's not a lot in between, is there?
No, there's also not a game that's reached the 10-minute mark yet, which is surprising, really. It's just a clear representation of how the games are going. It's very topsy-turvy and sort of very, it's very attacking. There's so many errors, cheap errors. Let's hope, staying impartial, trying as much as possible, let's hope Lily can regroup and start in.
Staying impartial, but trying to support Great Britain. I mean, I think, yeah, just we talked about glass court play, but I just think it's both players are showing a little bit of a lack of experience playing on the glass. I think that's reflected in the length of the match. I think if we'd seen this on a traditional court, there's a good chance the match would have been lasting longer, the rallies would be longer. But that that's probably breaking their rhythm. It's interesting to see. Now, I think the first 6-7 points in this game are massive in terms of the outcome of this whole... this whole semi-final?
Well, of course, in the fifth game you're going to get off to a good start, particularly in this match where it seems like the first few points have been the most crucial of each game.
Has a blood injury, so she has as long as necessary to stop the bleeding before play commences.
So Iker's come straight back onto court here, trying to get the ball warm. Possibly told by her coach, try and keep the momentum that she's just had, whereas Lily stayed back, is chatting with the GB team. Josh Taylor seems to be taking charge. I can't see Simon down there. No, there seems to be three of them. She seems to be getting taped up on her knee. I don't know if she's taking an injury timeout or not. But the England physio is down there with Lily. It could be that she's cut her knee when she kept falling on her knees, Jack. Seem to be putting kind of black tape on the knees. There is a blood rule in squash, isn't there? I mean, have you come across that when you've been playing on the tour? Have a stop for a blood injury?
Yeah, a couple of times. When you dive around and slide around, you can quite a lot catch your knuckles on the floor, or catch a knee on the floor like Lily's done there. And the old trick is to get a marker pen, and obviously if you put a plaster on, but you can see the blood through the plaster, then you have to forfeit the match. So
I think they've gone one better here, Jack. I'll wait to see if you can spot it, but I'm not sure you're going to see any blood through the GB flag that she's now putting on her right knee. But it is a strange rule. That's one of my least favourite rules of squash, with a blood injury, because you can do anything you want as long as the blood doesn't show through. And so you have this kind of strange scenario where people tend to put dark things over the blood to stop it showing through, but
pack a Sharpie just in case.
It doesn't necessarily mean the blood has stopped. So it seems a strange rule, that, and particularly when you're watching. I was listening to the rugby on the way in today, and you often see blood injuries in rugby, and they seem to be able to stay on the field of play. So I'm not sure exactly what the reason for it is, to be honest.
Yes, let.
wonder if she'll call video referee.
Yeah, that's dangerous, isn't it, this early on in the fifth.
Both players get one review per game. If the review is successful, they keep that review.
Handout, one.
But if they use it and then they lose it, they don't get another unless the game goes to 10 points all.
Well, that's all instance there where, you know, a straight volley drive or a straight drop would be a much more effective shot.
Yeah, she's almost trying to hit something ridiculous, isn't she, there?
Yes, lad.
Or overcomplicated, yes, I think lad. That's the expression, isn't it?
One all.
Yeah, it's a very effective shot. She played it a few times here in this match, but problem is if you start overplaying it, then your opponent starts reading it and it opens up the court quite nicely.
Yes, lad.
Stop start, ball's in the middle. Probably just was a let that, but it's finding it hard to get out of each other's way there. So it's certainly better again from Lee here. This is a little bit more construction on the tee. Two or three balls in the road at the back, and there's a mistake.
And out 2-1.
I think that just picks up, like you said in the last game, you don't have to go short to hit an effective shot, do you? It's so important that they just build in the back corners, get the tee position.
But the more to the point, you can attack going, you know, going long as well.
Yeah. What's that pressure? I mean, you mentioned playing Josh Masters, who's actually due on this afternoon. Is it the next match or the one after? I'll have to just double check the schedule.
Yeah.
Is he he's the next match on court, isn't he? You've obviously been playing. Yeah, his next match on court. But you've been playing him in training, and then I'm sure one of the big differences when you're playing against a top 50 player to where you are right now in your own game, Jack, is just the quality of that length hitting.
Yeah, 100%. And it's quality of length hitting and weight of shot, absolutely. And, you know, when you're playing these guys, you constantly feel like you're digging out the back corner and trying to hit the ball high, which if you're hitting the ball high and then loose against Josh Masters, he's going to bury it.
Stroke to Taylor.
Yeah, very skillful player, Josh. I'm looking forward to seeing that match.
Three,
I believe you're doing the commentary on that game as well, is that right?
I will be. I think with the MC for the day.
Yeah, Chris is going to make a reappearance, isn't he, I think.
Yes, let.
She's thinking about the review there. But she's not happy with the decision there, is she, Aika?
I think it was a let, but I do think Lily could really play those. A bit unorthodox position, but I don't know, I feel like she'd benefit more from playing those balls.
A couple of times she's gone through and you'd think that she could have gone into it and played it. Actually, put more pressure than... He's certainly having a let. It's a big thing in squash, isn't it? We're very much in the last probably, would you say, two seasons of you find the players are being encouraged to try and play the ball way more than they've ever played the ball before. Reducing those let scenarios and almost getting into stroke and kind of no let scenarios, isn't it?
Yeah, I do feel like it created a lot of confusion, a lot of ambiguity, actually. On tour, because it... You never know whether to ask or not ask, really. And a lot of times, I felt like referees became too strict and became too, you know, what should be a standard let became a no let for very little reason. And then, unfortunately, because you have to remain consistent, which is good, you do have to remain consistent, but if it's consistently wrong, then it is detrimental to the game.
I think from the refereeing perspective, it's not easy to referee a match, but I do think... If that's the perception from the players, it could well be that they've tried to go hard initially to try and really get people used to having to play the ball as much as possible. And almost change the attitude, the mindset to that. Whether or not that will relax slightly, as you said, with some of the balls where you think, well, it's obvious the player can get that ball and will be remain to be seen, I guess. But certainly, I think... What's here to stay is trying to encourage people to play as much as they possibly can, and as you said, I think Lily would have benefited a couple of times already from doing that in this match.
Out. Hand out.
It's a 7-6, Jack. How are you finding it? Are you going to call it?
Well, I'm going to stick with my initial decision and say Lily in five. But the next couple of points are absolutely crucial, aren't they? Well, I suppose every point is crucial at this stage, but...
We're going to go to a tie-break here. It's going to be somebody in a tie-break situation. So
yes,
let's get your mortgage on it, finishing 11-9, Jack, yes, or anything else.
6-7.
As Chris quite rightly pointed out earlier, my predictions are useless. Tight as Joey Bank would say if it was PSA. Joey is an ex-University of Birmingham student who is he was a top 25 player, wasn't he? But he also is now the kind of full-time commentator on the PSA tour. He's got a strong following. Probably does a better job than I'm doing right now.
Oh, come on, Daisy.
He's very popular, isn't he? He's
got a very charming northern accent.
Yeah, there's people tuning off because they can't understand what I'm saying, I think. Longer KG rally here. Has that gone out?
No, I think it stayed in.
It's definitely an appeal, wasn't there? It'd be interesting to see if there's any review around that. Not needed. She'd come on to win the rally anyway.
Hand out, 8-all.
Well, it's definitely not a time for a cheap shot. We've seen a few of those from both players here throughout the match. There's a place in the final on the line. Probably would be the biggest stage for either player, would you agree? In terms of where they are in their career so far.
It's a great shot. No, exactly. It's a great opportunity for these players.
9-8.
That's a beautiful drop as well, wasn't it?
She keeps going with that body serve, doesn't she? A few times you've kind of almost thought she was going to hit it down. Well, that's a good shot.
Oh.
So that's predicted. Not looking like a tie break. 2-point lead just at the vital time here for Lily. And it's match ball for a place in the final.
Yeah, it's very well. Patient rally at the end.
11-8, match to Taylor. 3-2. 11-1.
Well, Tatey, you owe me a pint.
11-2, 7-11.
Yeah, 3-2.
A very strange match, wasn't it? Very up and down, swings of momentum. But it's Lily Rhiann Taylor.
Yeah, and it's nice to have a GB finalist. I think we'd hope with Grace we might have two, but it's nice to have a GB finalist. I think Chris Truswell is now going to say a few words.
Well, my heart rate, so it felt like a bit of a roller coaster watching. How was that to actually play it?
Gosh, that was really tough. She was at the moment, it was really hard to get in the room. She was constantly like, because of the pace of you, just either going one way or the other, and I was happy
with it. Well, after winning that first so easily and then losing the second, what did you. How did you kind of refocus after that second game?
I just had to try not to think negatively, just keep positive, get in front, try and play my game and sell myself again. Every single time one of us got momentum, it's just a bit of a
And enjoying the glass court? Are you a fan of the glass?
Yeah, it's a great spectacle, great for everyone, great for everybody to come and watch and support some really good people. So, yeah, it's great.
Last question, obviously final tomorrow against Alexa. Are you familiar with her? Have you played her before, or is this going to be the first time?
It's going to be the first time. Never played her before, so it's going to be interesting. She's obviously very strong, so yeah, I'll just have to prepare
myself. Okay, well, best of luck tomorrow. Another round of applause, please, for Lily and also for Aika Asman. The next match will begin in a few minutes' time.
So as Lily goes off to see the Great Britain team and get some high fives and some congratulations, just see Josh Taylor at the bottom of the picture there, who is the coach in that match, talking to Simon, Lily's dad. Please stay with us. So that was the conclusion of the ladies' semi-finals, and Alexa Pienaar from South Africa won the first match against Zoe Fu from Malaysia. And as you just saw there, Lily Taylor beat Aika Azman to take her place in the final tomorrow. That match will take place at 4 o'clock, I believe. But next on court today, we've got the men's semi-finals taking place. The first semi-final, I believe, is Joshua Masters of Great Britain. He is taking on a Malaysian. I'm going to let Jack, can you help me up with the pronunciation on this one? But Sayafik, is that how you pronounce it? We should have checked this.
Yeah, Sayafik Kamal.
Sayafik Kamal. 3-4 seed versus the 2 seed, so it's gone to seeding. Yeah, Josh, obviously you're very familiar with. I guess you're not so familiar with the Malaysian. Not someone you've played.
No, not I think speaking to Josh's dad earlier on today, and he did say that they have played each other a couple of times. Masters coming out on top of both occasions. It should be an absolute cracker. Is Chris Tresswell again, the MC, introducing the players?
He is just introducing the players, yeah. The other semi-final, so the other men's semi-final will be between Tuns from Yip of Hong Kong, and he is playing Adin Idraki, so that'll be the last match on court later today. But for now, we'll pass across back to Chris.
World Tour titles. He's the 3-4 seed for this tournament. He's from Malaysia. Please welcome Sayafik Kamal. And his opponent is a mathematics graduate from UWE. He's currently ranked at 53 on the PSA World Tour. Both of his matches so far in this tournament have been very impressive 3-0 victories. He's the second seed and he's from England. Please welcome Josh Masters.
So I was just informed by you, Jack, that I could have got my pronunciations wrong there. So do you want to tell us about this men's second semi-final, the one that will follow on from this match?
Well, firstly, let's go for this one, because I think you said Yip's name wrong. I think it's Sifung Yip.
No, but he's not playing in this match, Jack. You're not doing very well. This is
No, I know. You said the second semi-final, didn't you?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, sorry. Sorry. I thought you said the same with this match.
Oh, sorry.
No, but sorry, you said that the pronunciations on the second semi-final weren't right. So
I do apologise. This semi-final with Joshua Masters of Great Britain versus Sayafik Kamal,
and followed by
Sifung Yip, the number one seed, versus Adin Idraki. We've got some very intriguing and very exciting.
So that's Hong Kong versus semi-finals in the second semi-final. I do believe Master of Ceremonies, Chris Truswell, is doing the commentary on this this match, but he hasn't appeared just yet. But while the players are knocking up, I'll go and see if he's around. I'll leave you in the capable hands of Jack Turner.
All the cards filling up even more, and the players here warming up. And I'm joined by the shining light of my day, Chris Jussaw. How you doing, Chris?
It's rare I get introduced like that, Jack, so thank you very much. Yeah, I think this is, well, the crowd's increasing because of the home player here, Josh Masters, and I think this could be probably the match of the day so far. Both of these guys are top 80. Josh is obviously just outside the top 50, and Safiq is 79. So I think we could have a real good battle here. Actually, I saw Safiq play yesterday, and he looks quite strong, physically very strong. And obviously we've got that lefty right-handed matchup, which is always interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. And we talking about home players. We just saw Lily Taylor there have a very interesting, intriguing sort of match, wasn't it? Very up and down. She came through, prevailed 3-2.
I think she probably did. Yeah, she deserved that on the whole. I mean, she ran away with that first game so quickly. And sometimes when you win a game that quickly, you know there's going to be a response. You know you're not going to win a match, a semi-final match like that, without breaking a sweat. So she did well then to regain regain her composure and fight it out in the fifth. But yeah, it was a real roller coaster.
Well, I don't really know much about the Malaysian here. Zuse 79 in the world. I know these two have played each other twice before.
All right.
And
you got
Josh,
the stats, yeah.
I spoke to Josh's dad earlier on today, so and I know that Josh has.
I think he's got a winning record.
Has got a winning record of 2-0. So he has got the advantage there, but you never know. And
obviously likes that matchup against the left-hander. I mean, I know that he's now working with Rob Owen as well, who's a left-hander. So maybe you know, he's not going to get fooled by that.
Well,
you know,
Rob has self-proclaimed one of the best techniques in the world, and you know, he's having a constant pressure sessions off Rob. He's sending you the wrong way. It's demoralising. Yeah. So Josh is well prepared, really, to be.
You've got to watch Rob when he's on that forehand side.
Yeah, show you some serious options.
Yeah, but it's interesting that Josh has chosen to move up to Birmingham. Obviously, he's been in Bristol the last few years at university and training with the Shabagi brothers. But I think from what I can gather, he just needed a change of scene. So I think moving up to Rob and to Rob Owen's academy is obviously. The sort of basically from the summer period, isn't it? And he seems to be playing very well for it. So
yeah,
I'm sure
absolutely.
You've probably seen him more than I have, but he was very impressive in his first two matches here. He's especially his quarterfinal yesterday, which could have been tricky, and he dispatched the guy from Hong Kong very, very quickly.
Well, yeah, Josh is a bright guy. I think he did maths as his
pure maths. Yeah,
pure maths there. Yeah.
So he's got all the angles worked out.
But he's a bright guy, and he knew exactly what he needed to work on. He's always been a bit of a shot player. He hits a very nice ball, and he's quite a lot of nicks. But maybe his fitness and his movement was something he could work on. But he's, you know, since coming up to start training with the boys at the ROA. He's hit the ground running, hasn't complained once. His attitude's been fantastic, and I say he's getting fitter every day, and his movement's getting much better as well.
I'm going to guess that I know they've played twice before, but I would just assume this is probably the first time they've played on the glass court, and I'll have to check that, but I would think it was. So be interesting, because I think the glass suits Josh quite well with his shot making skills. It's quite a dead court, so he does seem to he does get some rewards. So she likes to sort of, you know, he looks for the volley a lot, and he has a really good sort of cross, you know, faded volley cross court. He used that a lot yesterday. He was working really well on this glass court.
I as a contrast to the previous semi-final with the women's match, we have a much more patient sort of display here. Both players trying to find their length.
Yeah, I think they're both trying to settle in, but I actually think, as well as Josh, I think Safiq is not afraid to put the ball in short either. So I think we'll see sort of medium length rallies, but with the intent to attack as soon as they get the correct opening, which is what we want to see. That's what I want to see.
Quite right. Quite right.
Yeah. It's a nice hold.
That's lovely. But he's holding that movement, and then it, but as not to cross over from the previous match, but we were talking about attacking long and holding the movement and then punching it deep like that. And so the opponent's constantly in the back corner digging the ball out. And as I said, with someone like Josh, where he has those ability with his racket, if you hit a loose ball against him, particularly when you're digging out under pressure, he will put you under considerable pressure, if not win the point.
And if he doesn't win the point, like I say, it's just building pressure throughout a rally, so over 2, 3, 4 shots, and it's kind of,
exactly.
If you're on the end of that, it's like a slow death, really.
Well, it's an investment. You know, you have one hard rally after another, and slowly, over the course of a 40-50-minute match, then, you know, your opponent's much more tired.
I'm surprised you've not got a saying for that. You'll have to think of one.
Yeah, okay. I'll get the notepad and pen out now.
Good start from Josh, 5-1, and reasonably quickly. A couple of errors from Safi, a couple of winners from Josh.
Invest is best. Also great. I'll work on it.
It's not your best, but I've heard worse. Josh does look very comfortable early on. He doesn't look rushed at all, does he? Yes,
that.
Physically, he looks strong as well. I guess that's part of the summer. That's the summer work that's been put in.
Absolutely, and also because he's his previous matches. I think one's gone over like sort of the half an hour mark, has he? So he's been very 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 fresh.
No, he should feel absolutely fine. Yeah.
Both players giving it a fair old wallop, aren't they?
Yeah, well, we did see, I think, especially in the first girls' semi-finals, that they were hitting the ball hard, but it wasn't really going anywhere. It was still dropping half court, whereas Josh and Safiq are hitting it a bit harder, but they're actually getting the length to the back of the court. To step up and volley. He's definitely controlling the tee at the moment.
Oh,
it's nice.
Lovely.
That's that faded sort
absolutely
of volley,
that's
volley
liquid
cross.
Squash. It's a gorgeous shot, isn't it? So effective. Second bounce rolling into the nick.
Yeah, sort of hitting the ball back across Safiq's body, and it's tough. That's a tough movement. Tough movement to make. Hollywood finish there, but it just popped out a little bit too much. cheap error, but it was a good rally up until that point, wasn't it? They were both patient, but they were mixing heights and pace.
Very patient.
And Kamal's just gone for a shot that wasn't really on there.
No, he was sort of in defensive position, wasn't he? And there again, the ball's slightly behind him. But I suppose it's Josh's length that's causing him to make these errors, isn't it?
Maybe
I mean,
he's looking for a quick winner because he's not getting much change out of the longer rallies. But obviously that's when you start to rush and snatch and go for shots that you've not really worked the opening enough. So that's three unforced errors in a row, and the game runs away pretty quickly.
You know, but you've got to force your opponent to make try and hit difficult sort of winners, as it were, or force the errors. But at the moment, it's very cheap, and at this sort of level, you know, where Josh is 50 in the world, this guy's 79. It's sort of you expect not to make any cheap errors, and you have to work for every single point. Yeah. Nice little shot.
Well, I think that's a pretty ideal first game for Josh there, because even though it was only 8 minutes, the first three or four rallies were a majority of that time, and then he's just run away with 5 or 6 points at the end without having to do. He was working the rallies well, but Kamal has hit a few tins, and Josh has just got away 11-3. Dominant first game.
Seconds.
So Josh is on court before the 15 seconds has been called.
Well, he's probably warming the ball up, isn't he? Trying to make it nice and hot before going on.
Yeah, he's clearly doesn't need too many words of wisdom from his whoever's coaching him in his corner.
No, exactly. It was an ideal first game. He hit his lines really nicely. His opponent unfortunately made quite a few unforced errors. And
if you were Malaysian national coach, what would you have said to Safiq in between those games?
Well, first of all, I'd say try and get more into the match. Really, like, perfect example. Just trying to find those lengths, try and get the width past Josh's volley. Just try and get a bit more in the back corners. And if you are under pressure, try and use a bit more height, I suppose.
He's a tough person to get off the tee, isn't he, Josh? With his height.
Very much so. These
balls are kind of mid. I mean, the perfect volley in height, I think he's either got to go lower or higher, really. It's too much as sort of mid-court, really. And Josh is going to, you know, that's exactly where he wants the ball to be.
But it's much better there for the Malaysian, because he got forced on open, didn't he? He went, obviously, the shot that he went for was a bit too, I'm going to say, ambitious, maybe. But it's much better for, that's a great shot as well, isn't it? Kill on that forehand side. And they run it in tight, the rally's out of sight.
You want a reaction for that? Oh, yeah. I like that one.
Good one.
That's a good finish.
Yeah, clever play.
It's interesting because you can kind of see Josh has clearly got a game plan, or he's got certain patterns that he wants to play here. Whereas I think Safiq is more reactionary and is almost a little bit more random, isn't he? He doesn't seem to have a clear structure, whereas Josh, I don't know whether it's because he's played him twice and beaten him twice, but he seems to have a definite game plan.
Yeah, I don't know really. I mean, I say at the moment Josh hasn't actually had to do necessarily implement that much of a game plan because
it's a basic game plan, I suppose, isn't it? And it's working
exactly.
I mean, is that top spin?
Well, that was outrageous. Sorry, you were saying.
It's gone now. Too late. I'm amazed by that. Oh yeah, that was. He did mean that. Interesting.
Oh,
that is
delicious. Worthy of a Michelin star, would you say?
definitely a Michelin star.
We've got
a few of those in Birmingham, actually. I think the most outside of London. Second city. Not sure Josh has been to any of them yet, though, since he's been here, has he? I think living in King's Heath, he's only a short walk from Carter's in Moseley.
Have you been a few times?
I haven't, but I have a. It's on the list of things to do fairly soon, actually. Nice finish.
At the moment, Birmingham's coming very quickly, sort of the home of squash in the UK, but certainly we've had the British Junior Open here, we've got the World University Games here as well, Commonwealth Games it will be here as well in a couple of years. So
there's also the European Team Championships next year at Edgbaston. There have been a lot of events, I think, between Edgbaston Prior and the University. I think it's great, you know, National Club Championship finals, National Racquetball. Plenty of events, National League at the University, or PSL. It's great. It's great that they've managed to get events this size and stature. This new facility is obviously fantastic at the University as well. This arena with the glass courts in is perfect. I think all the players, everyone that I've spoken to, and a lot of these players have travelled and played in a lot of places around the world, and everyone seems really impressed with the setup here. And and the organisers deserve a fair pat on the back.
Quite right. Really good straight line hitting down that forehand side, isn't it, from Josh? Every time he's trying to switch it back onto the motion's backhand, isn't he?
Yeah, it's pepper in the backhand, really. That is a common tactic, isn't it? Right handers against left, and I guess left handers try and do it somewhat to right handers as well, but it's definitely a target spot. And then a quick one, a quick one whipped back across. Almost like a catch him out, keep him honest.
Should be. looking at Josh's forehand, he normally he sort of winds his forehand up a bit. You know, he has sort of not a closed grip, but he arches his arm, so it sort of it looks sort of closed. So he creates a lot of power and a lot of whips it a lot, particularly from the back of the court. But it looks like there, so it's quite closed. But recently, I think he's looking there when he's got volleying short, particularly he's opening his racket face a lot nicer, actually, a lot better.
Do you think that's part of some of the stuff he's been working on?
I think so. I think it's just been it's a recent change that he's trying to implement a bit more.
Open racket face.
Yeah, absolutely. Open the racket face and takes more pace off the ball as well, going short, and a bit more control, obviously.
I know Rob's very keen on an open racket, isn't he?
100%.
Get that edge through the ball. I think that's the correct decision. He needs to play that, really. It's a bit. It'd be a very cheap let.
Just talking about this open racket face. Josh sort of there. He closed his racket face a bit there, I thought.
That's good width. Don't apologise for that.
Absolutely.
Hitting your targets. It's not both cross court routine. It's not for nothing. Takes into game ball, four game balls. I think a two love lead will be tough to come back from.
Whoa! What a shot! Outrageous from the Malaysian. Leaped up like a salmon. Slapped at home. Great shot. Just need three more of those.
I've seen no lets given for that this week.
Yeah, I know. Maybe should have gone and played through it, but no, gone and played it. But do they both have their review?
Yes, no. Then we've not had any reviews yet, have we?
No. Interesting. Surprised Malaysian didn't review that one, but particularly at 10-7 down.
Nice.
Whoa, just slayed in.
Easy afternoon for the video referee.
He's got his little coat on at the moment, isn't he? Cozying up.
Oh, nice. Oh, there we go. Just what we wanted.
Oh, I think that's a good shout. I think
that could be a no-let or a stroke.
Exactly.
I don't think it's a let. I think it's one or the other.
The assistant referee just sprung into action. Bear with us just a moment as we get the video assistant
up and running. Due to technical difficulties, we continue with my call, yes, let.
Wow, Josh isn't happy about that one.
Yes, let. 7-10.
That's a shame, because I'd have been interested to see what the video ref would have given there.
Makes the video ref's job even easier now, doesn't it? Yeah, it doesn't matter though, because Josh have loaded the Sky's drive there. And Joshua Masters of Great Britain leads 2-0.
Thanks.
15 seconds.
Well, Joshua Masters of Great Britain in a very advantageous position here. Going to be the second Great British player to make a final here today after Lily Taylor in the women's event.
Yeah, and obviously after the singles is completed tomorrow, there's a move straight on to the team event starts Monday morning, and that runs Monday to Wednesday. And that will be an interesting event. Obviously, Malaysia, Great Britain, Hong Kong, and actually there's the French team. There'll be some really competitive matches there. I think it's two men and a woman in a team. So I think there's going to be some matches that are going to be really, really interesting. And obviously, be interesting to see who ends up with the gold medal at the end of the week. Going for gold.
So do you know do you know the formatting of the team event then?
Yeah, it's there's 13 teams playing, so it's actually three pools of three, and then there's one pool of four, and they all do round robin, and then the winners of each group will play off semi-finals, the runners-up will play off 5-8, and so on and so forth. So same as the singles where it's Monrad, every position is accounted for at the end of the week. Perfect length, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Straight off the serve. Really nice weight of shot there from Josh.
Talks about tacking going deep there as well. Didn't have to hit it hard either, did he?
Get the height right, that'll take it to the back.
Insightful. Well, it's a much better start, isn't it, from Kamal? He's put a couple of really nice kills in, hasn't he, on his forehand side, and
put Josh under a bit of pressure. You'd expect a response for someone who's top eight in the world, really. I think wouldn't expect him to go away too easily, so he just has to change his game up a little bit, be a little bit more disciplined, and just sort of hang in there, really. You'd be a bit disappointed if he gave up the ghost. Or that finish from Josh there was pretty spectacular.
Read it. Just put the top of in as well. Got in that position there. He was overstretched, wasn't he? Just using height a bit more, maybe lob up. Give himself a bit more time to recover.
Josh Shaney would play that there.
I think
going
so,
straight
yeah.
To the front wall, wasn't
I really
it?
Don't like that rule, actually. You know, when you're drilling your opponent, it shouldn't. I know the opponent, you know, it's a bit give and take. The opponent has to try and present the whole front wall to the, you know, to the guy hitting the ball, but.
Can be taken advantage of, though, definitely, can't it?
Absolutely. Depends how much you like your opponent. But then I suppose if it was changed to a let and ball would be coming round from those angles, few people would play them. You know, if they're getting tired, they can just easily ask for a let, and the play would break up even more, wouldn't it? So Well, Miles is getting pretty frustrated here, actually, because he's won the past 2 points, but he's given his opponent a lot of opportunities. It was a loose drop, wasn't it? And
might just be a slight drop in concentration. The first two games were very, very high level.
A drop in concentration, but I think Kamau has actually played much better. And not making as many cheap errors as he did before.
I'd review that if I was Josh.
Well, here we go. The video assistant's going to spring into action again, I think.
Here we go.
Oh. Yep. Let's hope it's going to be working. Here we go.
I mean, this is probably a better angle to see it from. Not a lot of interference. It's dead, isn't it?
No, it's an inch-perfect drive. I personally think that should be a no-let, really. What do you think?
Well, that's why I said he should have reviewed it, yeah.
Yes, let decision upheld.
Well, it proves what we know, isn't it?
Yes, let. Right side, please. That's the serve, 5 seconds.
Worth an ask there, really. You could have.
No, I think he committed to the completely wrong line, didn't he? And
he did. I would have wrapped my racket around Kamau and pushed him towards the ball. Pace has gone up, but the accuracy has dropped a little bit, hasn't it?
7-4. Well, after being down in this game, Masters is after a couple of quick exchanges. Quick
clawed it back, hasn't
exactly.
He?
Oh, that's a great shot. Using his body there nicely as well, and a great angle. You're not over hitting the angle, so it hits off the sidewall. He's running it into that corner there, so his opponent can't recover. So after being, I think, 7-5 down, Masters puts back to 8-7 in the third. Well got. Great movement from both players there. Oh, what a rally.
Tight.
Drop was high, but it was tight, wasn't it? And if it ain't tight, it ain't right. It's a great shot. Well, my co-commentator Chris has just left to do the emceeing. He's very optimistic that Josh is going to get this done, but not a command has anything to say about it. A salmon strikes again. and I'm joined back here with the devilishly handsome Jonathan Tate.
Thank you, Jack. The first person to say that to me this week.
Nine.
Hopefully on the last. So Chris is headed on downstairs just in case this game does close out at 3-0. Josh would have a second British semi-finalist. Yeah, sorry, finalist. Semi-finals now. We have a second British finalist. So that's match ball to Josh. Go to review, Jack, do you?
No, it's clever movement though from Kamal, wasn't it, to get behind him, get his racket behind Josh like that?
Yeah, he got on it quick, didn't he?
He did, yeah.
So, first tie break. It's very tough rallies in this third game.
Well, Kamal's played much better, hasn't he, in this third game. He's saying earlier he hasn't made nearly as many errors as he did in the previous games. That's a great shot.
Yeah, bit of frustration there from Josh. He's let those 2 points slip. You see him hitting the glass as he's
he's getting a warning from the referee. But it's nice to show a bit of passion, isn't it?
Well, I think it's a big thing. He's let a match ball slip there. Potential to take that game 3-0. And he's going to be across. But having said that, I think that was a good rally from Kamal. Do you?
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, it's a great shot, isn't it? Well improvised. And that's
11-4. Is that a signature Rod Owen shot there, Jack? I know it's a shot you spend a bit of time.
Could he play 8 or 9 shots from that position?
Well, he definitely had a like reception on that ball, didn't he?
Yeah.
So mid-court here. 4, 5, 6, 7 shots in a row there. All going mid-court. No one's getting a length. A bit cagey.
And they're not varying paces either. It's all you know, walloping the ball as well, isn't it? That's better.
Those last 3 or 4 shots, and both players just now finding their bit in the range again.
As well from Masters, there have been a few exchanges on his forehand side, on Kamal's backhand side. It's much better. He's been rewarded as well with the patience. So that rally's earned him.
Is it second? Second match ball, yeah. Sorry, I was trying to remember what point I came in on this commentary. Was it 9-all? I think it was. Second match ball.
9-8, yeah.
Ooh, he was moving it behind him there, wasn't he there? Trying to get on the volley quickly. It's a nice lift, yeah.
Just cross court and well finished as well.
13-11, match to Masters.
Well, a round of applause from both of us there, wasn't it? It's a great lift and a lovely finish.
Absolutely.
So Chris was right to head off. You almost called it wrong with Kamal having game ball there, but as you can see, there's Chris walking back on the court. I think he's going to have a few words with Josh Masters.
Josh, that was a very professional 3-0 win. You must be pretty pleased to get off in 3 against someone of Kamal's standard.
Yeah, I'm very happy to get off in 3. We played 2 the ball and then proper game to him, so almost happened again today, but happy to get off in 3.
Good. Well, I was wondering, obviously you graduated last year obviously eligible to play this year. I wondered how you found playing squash to the level that you did while you were studying. How you managed to combine the study and the squash, and that, do you prefer it now you're just playing squash?
I definitely prefer just playing squash. Probably should have studied maybe a little bit more than I did, but I was enjoying my squash, and my squash was going very well, so I got 3 out at the end still, so
and just finally, I don't know if anyone knows, Josh has recently relocated to Birmingham, so this is now your hometown, or it has been over the summer, I guess, for a little while longer. Obviously moved to West Warwick to work with Rob Owen and the group of players there. What was the reason behind that move? Did you just need a bit of a change from... Yeah, what was the reason behind it?
Get away from mum and dad. Players up here in Birmingham, it's more centralised, it's easier to get hits with people. Obviously Rob's a very good coach, there's a lot of players are doing very well recently as well, and the song's been good, it's up like 10 minutes down the road, and it's a pretty cool lot of fun in there for this one, but it's been a good move so far, I think.
Right, well, congratulations, well played, good luck in the final. Ladies and gentlemen, Josh Masters and Safiq Kamal. Next match will be in a few minutes' time.
So, like Lily Taylor, Josh Masters there, just going off to the congratulations of the GB team. I think he took a few high fives on the way out. As was mentioned, he's pleased to get off in 3 games and be the first finalist of the men's. Next semi-final coming up is in a few minutes' time. We've got one player from Hong Kong taking on a Malaysian. Obviously, Tun Sung Yip from Hong Kong is known to both of us. Top player in the world. I think he's about 31 in the world. Is that right? Jack's just checking his notes, but he's not 100% sure. I think he's 31 in the world. He's been very, very strong in this competition so far, and I think it's going to be a very, very tough afternoon for the Malaysian. But at the moment, court cleaners are on, and I think we're also waiting for a new commentator to also arrive in the commentary box. So for the next few minutes, we'll leave you just with the images.
Yeah.
Okay, final match of the afternoon on the glass court, second semi-final. First player I'd like to welcome onto court. He's currently ranked 92 on the PSA World Tour, but is the winner of 4 PSA World Tour titles. He's currently at the University of Malaya studying sport management. He's a 3-4 seed from Malaysia, Adin Idraki. His opponent is at a career high of 25 in the world on the PSA rankings. He's also the defending champion of this tournament. He graduated in business admin at the City University of Hong Kong last year. So far he's had 3-0 wins. He's the number one seed from Hong Kong. Please welcome Si Fung Yip.
So welcome back, second final. Not sure if you would have been able to pick up the microphone on the introductions on the court, and it was confirmed that Yip, who you're seeing in the caption right in the front corner there, he is now currently ranked 25 in the world. I think it's just showing the results that he's had in previous matches, but he hasn't spent much time on court this week. He's been fairly ruthless in his matches and has won each of these previous games 3-0. So Yip is 24 years old, so he's quite mature in some respects, probably one of the older players in this competition. I think the cut-off point is 25, 26, perhaps 26 years old. So at 24, he's one of the older players. He's at 25 in the world. He's also the defending champion of this competition. He is a bit like Josh now. He's a full-time player, graduated in business from the City University of Hong Kong. I think he must have had at least one. Well, we know he's had one full season on the tour since graduating from there. So his opponent is also 24 years old. He's also now got a men's PSA ranking of 92. And he's also had 4 PSA wins to his name.
Half time.
He was a sports management graduate, I think. Yeah, I think he's again like Yip, I think he's now quite graduated from university, so in sports management. So two players who have now playing full time. Jack Turney has taken his seat back in the commentary box, and just while the players are knocking up Jack, obviously very pleased, I would imagine, to have one of your training partners in Josh Masters through to a final.
Yeah, absolutely. I think he did very well as well to get it done in three. I think he played very well. I thought he contained Kamal quite nicely as well, particularly down the forehand wall. Quite tricky being a lefty. Yes, I'm absolutely delighted. Looks like all that training with Rob and myself is paying off. I'm really looking forward to this one. I really like Yip's style. He's like a big block of cheese. He's really, you know, he's solid, isn't he?
He's strong boy, isn't he? I mean, a few people talked today over the course of this week about his strength in his legs. And I mean, he really is. He is a strong unit. You can see he's training hard. You mentioned the training that you're doing, and obviously Josh has been doing the build-up to this event. 20 give us a bit of an overview of some of that stuff that Josh has been doing in preparation to make his first final?
Yeah, well, I can't go too much into depth about it, but we have a fantastic trainer called Rob Norman who comes in and gives us some you know, programs and stuff like that, particularly through the summer where a few of us have tournaments on. And
That's your off-court trainer, isn't it? That's kind of
off-court, but he helped the guy. Everyone got together and you know collaborated and created a good program filled with lots of circuits and running and ghosting and a good mix of all those sort of things. And you can tell all the guys from the ROA. It's a great setup, but everyone's doing now very well. You know, George Parker and Charlie Lee and obviously Joel Maker now, who's just over in Shanghai, just lost to
Simon Rosner this week. Yeah,
Simon Rosner, exactly. So, yeah, everyone's doing really well, and the summer training's paid off. I mean, you know, it was a brutal training, and every day was very tough. But you know, and you earn the days off. But you can tell we're reaping the rewards was now really, and. And you can see there, I thought like Josh was, even after just a summer, he looks like he's moved much better. I mean, he's able to...
He's looking stronger, isn't he?
He's looking stronger,
definitely looking
exactly.
Stronger from when he was a student. He, just, yeah, very much stronger than he was. Much stronger than he's lunging. Anyway, just walking up towards the commentary area is a very proud and smiley face looking GB coach. In this, Josh, there he is, a big smile on his face. Josh Taylor. Two finalists, and he's also one of the commentators for this men's final. So I'll pass you across to Josh.
So thanks for having us, John. Always a pleasure to be on the commentary here. So, did you enjoy that last match, Jack?
Yeah, absolutely. We just covered that bit. We were just talking about how Josh is looking much, as in Josh Masters. I mean, yourself, you're looking nice and trim as well, but Josh Masters looking much fitter and he managed to, you know, efficiently sort of dispatch a very good opponent, didn't he?
Yeah, I've been impressed with him all week. You know, as we've gone through the rounds, he's dispatched a couple of quality players, I think, quite comfortably. I think that was probably the closest anyone's taken Josh this tournament so far. I think, you know, Sfeek's got a few weapons, actually. If you get caught around the middle of the court, he's quite dangerous. And I think first game, Josh, you know, executed the plan very, very well, and then it became a bit of a scrap. But it's interesting to see how these two boys play now and how we're shaping up for the finals tomorrow, really.
Well, we've done this for every single match so far in both semi-finals. So at the start of this match, we were going to do predictions as well. John Tate already owes me a pint. So
just a solitary pint, Jack.
A solitary pint. So we'll see how you get on. What your prediction for this one?
I'm going to go Yip 3-love this one. He's a strong boy, Yip, and I think. Probably the favourite going into this event. How about yourself, Jack?
Well, he's the number one seed, Josh.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, he's the top seed. You're saying the obvious all night, are you?
What
is that who got your job?
You said he was the favourite. I agree with you. I think it will be too strong. And but I can't say I've actually seen much of a Dean. Have you seen?
Yeah, I've caught a little bit of these two Malaysian boys. They had a little bit of a spell last year in Manchester, actually, they were training with some of the boys up there for a little bit before the Worlds, I think it was. Nice lads. They're both kind of very Malaysian style players, really. You know, both move quite well, quite good around the middle of the court. If you can get the ball back in behind them. You know, you can start to expose him a little bit, and I think that showed in Josh's match, actually. You know, I think arguably a bit of patience could probably be something where if you can rally out a little bit against them, they do start to go for quite a bit. Dean definitely does. So, it'd be interesting to see how he does here.
I think, I mean, less so. I mean, he is now, I think, what is he, 20, 25 in the world?
Yeah, he's pushed up.
Yeah, absolutely. So he, I mean, I've seen you quite a few times, and he's got an absolute wicked boast, hasn't he? Mm. He's lovely, and he moves very efficiently as well. And I don't know, really. I think.
I mean, they're two emerging nations, aren't they? Malaysia, obviously, more sort of prominent, but Hong Kong are definitely an emerging nation in the world of squash, and both characteristically are quite strong movers in the game. Both probably very good around the middle. You know, if you're going to stereotype those two nations and how they play, and I think both these players probably show those characteristics. You know. Lovely working boast there.
That's what I'm talking about. He feels like he's so well, doesn't he? Not necessarily wins points from it, but you're right, working in that investment for the rest of the match.
Yeah, and I think, you know, if Yip can do that, it's someone where he's building continual pressure against opponents, and you know, his physicality can then come through. You know, you just have to look at the size of those quads. I mean, they're huge.
I'm thinking more of the calves.
Yeah, they're
like baby cows, aren't they?
They are indeed, yeah. You got some pistons on those legs. He's opened the court up there. You know, that pour from Adin there, really. You know, that cross court there just left him for dead.
So after a really good start there from Adin, where he went 2 love up, I think, in this first game. He's
that is all he went up, yeah. Yeah, Yip finds himself 8-2 up in this first game.
Well, as Josh Taylor, JT, has just had to nip out for a little team meeting for next week's sort of team competition. But I'm joined here by a player here at the University of Birmingham, and a volunteer here this weekend, George Parnell.
Good afternoon, Jack. It's a pleasure to be here with you.
Thanks very much, George. Well, how are you finding the event? It must be, you know, quite an experience.
Yeah, it's absolutely fantastic, and it's great to take advantage of the university's new sporting development. As you can see here in the main sports hall, we've got this glass court built especially for this event.
You got chatting to one of the floor specialists.
That's absolutely right earlier, yeah, it's quite interesting. I didn't appreciate the amount of research that goes into the flooring of these squash courts, particularly the glass ones, because obviously the dynamics of the ball bouncing off the glass are completely different to off-plaster walls. And apparently this is a major area of research and development in modern squash, particularly the type of resin used to seal the boards.
No, that's interesting. It's funny how the I think players will adapt their style of play, and they're playing on the full glass courts and those back courts, because obviously the court's much deader and the ball's not flying the same way, and you say the bounce is different with the different types of floorboards.
That's completely right. It's only natural for a player to have to adapt their game depending on where they're playing. Obviously the conditions, atmospheric conditions, obviously aren't important in squash, but in terms of the atmosphere that's given by the fans, etc.
Well, you say, but you know, the humidity will change from country to country. Obviously, Birmingham's not that hot. But
at the moment, no. And that will change the bounce of the ball, as we've seen.
Well, after that 7-minute first game, it's Yip who takes a very commanding lead at 11-4.
Absolutely. Is that the score you're expecting in the first game, Jack?
Well, after Idraki went 2 love up, you know, I thought it'd be a bit more competitive, but Yip showed what quality, what class he has, really.
And yeah,
made a few errors and was able to work a Dean and, you know, come out on top in the end, be a bit more patient and, you know.
He did indeed go 2-love up, but it was the opening of the first game, and as we say, the court they're using here, they haven't been playing on before. It's a completely naive event for them, so it's only expected that the first game would be just finding their feet.
Well, thanks very much, George Parnell, there, with wonderful insight into the different types of flooring that we have here and different squash courts. I'm joined again here by Josh Taylor,
hey,
GB
Jeff.
Coach. Just come back from your team meeting.
Yeah, sorry about that.
That's all right.
Team manager's staff, you know, important business. Yeah, just had to debate a little bit of a seeding panel review that's going on after the individuals tonight. Just had to make sure we got the contest in to hopefully seeded a bit higher for the team event.
And is that exactly? And is that how the seeding works? Then you take, is that in all events where you take the individual performances and then put them into the team event, and that's how the seeding works?
Yeah. So what we're applying here anyway is that there's been a seeding already made off the results from the individuals and the seeding from the individuals. We then had a period to contest. After the semi-finals tonight, before it goes to a team manager's review, and then from there they make the final seedings for the team event. Obviously, given the two wins for GB today, it gives us a slightly stronger position to contest anything. But you know, you've got two really strong teams for the team event in Hong Kong and Malaysia, so be interesting to see how the panel rules, really. But yeah, that was the important business. Yip's made a strong start again to this second game.
Yeah,
has been struggling, Jack, with a bit of an ankle injury, I've noticed, across the event. Getting strapped again tonight, yeah. But he doesn't seem to be affecting him too much at all, really.
5-1. I suppose his movement's not really being exposed as much as it at the moment, but
no, not as yet. I must say, I thought Adeem would put him under a bit more pressure than he has done so far in this match.
Oh, yippee!
Yippee indeed.
That's a lovely shot. Plucked it out of the air, didn't he? Caressed it into the cross court neck. Josh, you just got back from, was it India, for the World Juniors as well?
No, I didn't go. Lee and Laura Mazzara actually went to the World Juniors.
But you must be thrilled with the
Oh, it was a fantastic result, yeah. You know, overruled, really. Like, we've consistently started to do better and better at junior level across the last few events, really. Last few years, you know, it's an upward trend for England, which is obviously what we want to see.
Yeah. Oh, that's a lovely working boast.
It's quite tight, that.
Yes,
I guess there's an argument there that Yip should have taken the inside line there, really.
Yeah, perhaps. The decision was let, or are we having a video review?
No, I think it was just standard let. I don't think he's reviewed there, Jet, so I think it will stand.
Just saw Yip lift up his t-shirt, and the man is, as I said before, he's an absolute block of cheese. He's ripped, isn't he?
He's in incredible shape. The larger side of life in terms of muscular strength.
But can it be detrimental to the game to be, obviously, you can be too heavy, too strong, can't you?
I think someone like Yip, I think he's in quite in proportion. He's a big boy in terms of strength for his size, but I wouldn't say he was too big, would you?
No, it was more of a generalisation.
Generalisation?
Yeah, it was okay. In general, the people that... You know, when they get too big, too heavy, I mean, they'll be nice and strong around the middle, but if you work them a bit more, they get tired more quickly.
Well, it's obviously all about power to weight ratio, isn't it? That's the key. You know, a little bit like an F1 car, you want to be quite nimble, quite agile, fast around court, you know. It's obviously a sport where you've got to get that balance.
Quite right. That's your sports science degree.
Yeah, that degree really did help there. Interesting attempt at trickle boast there, I think, was what he was going for. I'm not quite... Oh, no, he was trying to straighten that off, wasn't he?
Probably, yeah. I mean, it was tight. I mean, I really liked his the shot off the back wall where he just lifts it and top spins it like that and runs it tight. Similar to doing a back wall boast, really, isn't it? Some ways, you know?
Is that the qualities that you like in a squash player?
Well, it was just an interesting shot, wasn't it? I know Selby likes to do it as well, doesn't he?
Yeah, I mean, someone like Yip can cover that quite well, can't he?
Well, absolutely, exactly. But it's the topspin that runs it in tight, doesn't it?
Yeah, using the strings. Well read across the middle there from Yip. It's going on the end of a brutal rally here.
That's that.
Going to end in a let. Oh, he's going for the review.
Put the video ref to use again.
Yeah, I mean, this is going to be an interesting one for the video referee, I think. Just looking at the line there, yeah. You're definitely spot on with the line, Jack. I think decision was upheld there. I think probably racket and prep was a bit high, wasn't it, for the ball quality?
Yeah, yeah. He does get across the middle very well, doesn't he, Yip? Just like the camera angle there.
Yeah, I'd agree with you there. He's strong around the middle.
And out.
9-5.
Just enough on that follow-up volley there from Yip.
Well, that's well read as well. He didn't get the width, did he, Nadim, at all? So that ball is giving him game ball. Oh, that's a lovely boast as well, isn't it?
And out. 6-10.
Oh, now was it? That was perfect.
Well read. That's the end of that second game. Yep, taking a two-game lead here in this second semi-final.
About that, folks. We've got another change, a final change here for commentary, and Josh Taylor's now gone to get a massage, or you know, chat to his team, and give him a bunch of high fives for a very successful day for GB. I'm joined again by our leading floor expert and all-round good guy and charmer, George Parnell.
Oh, hi there, Jack. And yeah, thank you very much to Josh for covering some of this commentary this evening. We rejoin the start of the third game in the semi-final match between Yip and Idraki, fighting for a place against Josh Masters in the final of this year's Fiju Squash World Championships. That will take place tomorrow. So Jack, just to summarise the second game, is it what you expected in terms of the performance from Yip and Idraki?
Pretty much. I think Yip's been getting across the middle very nicely. He's been in control of a lot of the rallies. The rallies have been, you know, highly competitive, but it's just been Yip's just been slowly outmaneuvering Idraki and putting him into those corners and just extending the court a bit more. And over time, that's just been, you know, sort of,
it's chipped away.
It's chipped away, exactly. And he's it's been a good workout for Yip. And I was about to say comfortable, but unfortunately he's just
completely the wrong way
there.
As I think you and Josh were discussing earlier, he's got an extremely powerful frame, a real athlete.
Yeah.
a real athlete, as Josh and Jack were discussing earlier. And I think we see that in his movement across the centre of the court, as you were saying, Jack. Perhaps it's that physicality that sees him edge ahead here.
Absolutely, and it's his physicality that makes him be able to get into those deep sort of lunges and being able to hold his movement as well. Not just get there quickly, but when he's there, he's able to hold his movement and create a bit of deception from it as well. And he's so stable on the ball, you know.
No, absolutely, yeah. And also what I was saying is come out of those lunges, spring back to the tee, and ready to go again.
Oh.
Some scrappy play down in the front right.
Well, that's a fantastic rally. Completely open.
So much movement from both players.
Another trickle. Oh, that's a great line as well. And the crowd erupts. It's the first time they've done that in a while.
And out. 2-4.
Hand in.
Dispatched.
No, I'm pretty sure I hit the middle of the tin, actually, unfortunately.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Well, things got a little frantic, haven't they? A little sort of bit wild, really. Some of the rallies, they haven't really found their length at the moment. They're hitting the ball very hard, but it's...
I think you're right. I think there's certainly less structure in the last few points to this
absolutely,
game.
Absolutely,
absolutely. Let's see if one of the players can establish some sort of parity here.
A bit more structure in this rally already, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Taking the ball early, but finding the length, and it's a tight shot as well.
Yeah, I don't know if you noticed that, Jack, as well. It's a great example of the economy of movement there from Yip and how easily he cruises in and out of those lunges.
I'm quite right. So Draki here, striving for parity. Well lifted from Yip, isn't it, at the front left corner.
Absolutely.
And again.
Once again.
Oh, he's made the error as well. It's a great rally, but much better from Draki, wasn't it? Much more patient play, and he's forced the error from Yip.
For parity.
I once had a pet bird that used to talk to me. It was parity.
Oh, that's a good one, Jack. I think we're playing a let for that last point. And I think this is a really important point for Draki to win in order to get a foothold in this match. If not, I think it's going to require a great deal of psychological work for him to get back in the game.
That's a great shot there from Yip.
Yeah, it is.
Ball was behind him and the strength there to end it. And oh, beautiful shot.
Yeah.
He's sort of off balance almost playing it, wasn't he? He was sort of running backwards. But
got it just right, very tight at the point of play for Draki. Oh,
so only Yip's normally so effective in that with that boast. It's his best shot. He floats it around and works his opponent, but he's made I think 3 errors in the past 6 rallies.
Yes.
7-8.
absolutely crucial point here.
It is. Idraki given another chance at parity.
Oh, it's a tight drop though, isn't it? Running in tight like that. But like a lot of drop shots, they, you know, when someone goes in short, they hit the sidewall before hitting the floor. But actually, it's probably better actually to, when you hit a drop shot, to bounce and then kick into the sidewall.
Absolutely.
So it runs
squeeze
tight.
It right into
exactly.
The sidewall, yeah. Very difficult.
Need more margin
time.
As well.
That's right. And we've seen Idraki gain that absolutely crucial point just then. And
do you know what he's earned?
He appears to have earned parity, Jack. Much like quite your avian pet.
Well, that's a quick pace, isn't it?
It is indeed.
Oh, thunderous drive. Oh, he's opened up the court.
Bizarrely confident shot.
Oh, he's made an error.
This could well be a Draki's opportunity.
Sinks there to the floor. Looking also awfully tired after that. He's doing a lot of work, but...
Yeah, there we see the cracks emerging, perhaps. Regardless of the outcome of this match, I think so far, Draki's certainly done himself proud. He's up against an extremely tough opponent whose reputation precedes him, even at this world stage.
Absolutely. I think he may be slightly disappointed with his maybe the first two games where
he wasn't passive.
Well, he wasn't passive, but he opened up the court too much and he was able to get in front. But here he's played some fantastic stuff, really. You know, it has been quite frantic at times, but it's obviously worked for him, and he's made a few more poor errors in some quite advantageous positions. Well, I'm not sure the Yip's ball there popped out, I know, didn't it? But
neck and neck at the end of this third game. Can Idraki edge ahead?
Oh, that's a thunderous volley,
absolutely,
isn't it?
Merciless. 10-9. Match ball. Will he use this as a springboard to the final?
Oh, he's clipped off the tin.
And that's it. That's it for Idraki.
But a fantastic match here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Fantastically well contested. But it's Yip, the number one seed, who marches on to tomorrow's final, where he faces
Joshua
Masters.
Absolutely.
Well, it's been a fantastic day here. And I think that was the last match of the day. The crowd's sort of slowly filtering out now. but we're going to have our final words with our MC for the day, Chris Truswell.
Second time in this competition. That looked comfortable-ish, a little bit in the third, looks a little bit tired. How are you feeling throughout the week? Are you feeling good?
I'm doing a bit all right, yeah. And I didn't play well. It's just not as easy as it was. And I'm happy that I win today. Tomorrow I'll play the match.
And how are you finding Birmingham? Have you been in the city yet and the facility here? Are you enjoying yourself?
I think Birmingham here is wonderful. The weather, the people, the setup, the campus here, everything is wonderful.
And final question, obviously tomorrow you're playing Josh Masters. Have you played him before? Or have you watched him play a lot?
Yeah, I've watched him play quite a few times against my teammates. But I haven't played him yet.
Congratulations, and we'll see you tomorrow afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, Sifung Yip.
Well, thank you. After you.
Just to round up the action from today, we've seen some fantastic matches and two key victories for our great British players, Lily Taylor and Josh Masters, both of whom will be making appearances in the finals tomorrow. Jack, I think you've got the times of the finals just there. Could you let us know?
Yes. Well, folks, tune in. On the women's side, the final will be taking place at 4 o'clock, and the men's draw, men's side, it will be 4:45. But we've had a fantastic day, haven't we?
Absolutely.
I just
want
to say a big thank you to everyone here, and a big thank you to you, George Parnell, on your debut as a commentator.
Oh, you're absolutely welcome, Jack. And I think we can't forget the volunteers. We can see them now cleaning the court. This event would, of course, not be possible without the generosity of our volunteers.
Absolutely. But we'll see you all again tomorrow. And for the time being, cheerio.
Cheerio, bye.